In this video, we're going to look at loading an airfoil into Xfoil from an airfoil coordinate file. This will be very useful to you as it will allow you to load custom airfoil shapes into Xfoil for analysis. This is brought to you by the Science of Flight. Let's get to it. The goal of this video is to load an airfoil into Xfoil using an airfoil coordinate file. This is going to give us the ability to import custom airfoils into Xfoil for analysis. The first step when importing an airfoil from a file is, of course, to download or obtain, or if you're brave enough, create an airfoil coordinate file. You usually just go and find the airfoil in a database. However, you might be using another software, or you might be using another method to get the airfoil shape. So this airfoil shape is actually saved into the airfoil coordinate file in XY coordinate pairs. That's why it's called the coordinate file, because you're using the coordinates of the airfoil shape. The X value being the location on the cord, and the Y value being the distance from the cord to the surface of the airfoil. There are two airfoil databases that I would recommend to you. UIUC airfoil database. UIUC stands for University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. This has a lot of airfoil coordinate files in different formats, so be careful. They're not all the same format. It also has a lot of really good reference material, so I would recommend that you go and check out that website. The airfoil that we are going to use in this tutorial is going to be the Clark Y airfoil. So if you go to the UIUC airfoil database and scroll down to the Clark Y airfoil, this is the one we're going to be using for this tutorial. Now you notice that there are two files for the Clark Y airfoil. There's the .dat file, which is the actual coordinate file that we're going to download. Now if we wanted to look at the airfoil, we can download or view the other file that you see there, the GIF image file, if we wanted to look at the airfoil shape. But for this one, we're just going to be importing the airfoil shape into Xfoil, so we're wanting to download the file on the left, the .dat file. So go ahead and right click and save as. Before we continue with this tutorial, let's go ahead and take a moment to look at the airfoil file formats that Xfoil recognizes and uses. The plain file format has just the X and Y coordinates in the file. It has no other data, it has no other strings of text or anything like that. It has just the X and Y values. As you see, each line is a different coordinate pair, an XY pair, used to make up the airfoil shape if you're plotting it. So each line is going to represent one dot, one place on that graph, on that shape. So these files can get pretty long in terms of the number of lines, just depending on how many points is used to, how many coordinate pairs or how many points are used to create the shape. The labeled format is very similar to the plain format. However, the first line of a labeled format is actually a string that contains the name of the airfoil. Now you have to be careful with what that string is. For instance, if that string has two numbers in it that Fortran will actually recognize as numbers, then it's going to kind of error out and have kind of an issue with the name, right? Because it's going to think it's a plain file and these first two numbers are the first coordinate point. So just be careful with how it's named. For instance, I have right here it named as the 0012 NACA. Now if I put a space between the two zeros and the 12 in the 0012, Xfoil is going to think that's the first coordinate pair, right? First X and the first Y values on the shape of the airfoil. So that is going to cause issues. So just make sure that if you're using a labeled, that string that they use for the label doesn't start with two numbers. There's some other issues with, for instance, using a T or an F, which Fortran thinks is like a true false value, a Boolean value. So you might need to try some different techniques first, like an underscore or something, to make sure that it doesn't think it's it doesn't think it's something other than a string. Now both the ISES and MSES file formats start with the string of the airfoil name, but after that you'll see that there's a line that has four number values. I believe these are actually because these files are used in different software. So those are like the boundaries of the box that you're going to house the airfoil in, right? So if you imagine this airfoil being in a wind tunnel, right, this would be like your test section, right? So you have your lower and upper X value and your lower and upper Y values. So that's kind of what happens with these two files. That's what those numbers are for those files. So Xfoil is actually going to look to see if it has four numbers on that first line of data. And if it does, then it's going to think that this is an ISES or an MSES file format. So just keep that in mind. Other than that, it's the same as the other file formats with just XY coordinate pairs representing the shape of the airfoil. Now the difference between the ISES and MSES is that the MSES can have multiple elements to that. You can kind of think of this as building up an airfoil by layering different pieces onto it, right? So you might have like a leading edge or a flap or the actual airfoil shape. And so you might see multiple elements inside of this MSES. You might see a line with 999 for both X and Y values. This is just separating the different elements. And just keep in mind that when you're building an MSES file, the first item is going to be on the top level, right? So the airfoil, the base airfoil, is going to probably be the last element in this file. And the higher up elements are going to actually, the higher up layers are going to be shown first before you can get down to that bottom airfoil. Now, just as a reminder, the leading edge is given the 0, 0 coordinate point, coordinate pair, and the trailing edge is the 1, 0 coordinate pair if you're dealing with a normalized airfoil. And we'll talk a little bit more about what a normalized airfoil, how it all works in a future video. Now, these coordinate pairs need to be placed in the correct order if you want the airfoil to load correctly. The order that it needs to be in is it needs to start at the trailing edge, go around the shape of the airfoil, and then come back to the trailing edge, right? So it goes trailing edge over one of the surfaces to the leading edge, and then it goes from the leading edge over the other surface to the trailing edge. Now, it doesn't actually matter if it's the upper surface and then the lower surface, or if it's the lower surface and then the upper surface. It does not matter. But what does matter is it starts at the trailing edge, wraps around the leading edge, and then returns to the trailing edge. So just make sure that the airfoil points that you are using are in the correct order. One of the reasons why I chose the Clark Y airfoil, besides being popular, is that it's actually in a wrong format. We'll talk about that on the next slide. Now, when importing an airfoil, you do want to check to see whether the normalization flag is on or off, because that's going to change how it's imported. If it's on, it's going to import the airfoil and normalize it to a unit chord with the leading edge at the origin. And if it's off, it's going to retain its shape, right, its size and its location in Cartesian space. So, you know, if for some reason you have an airfoil and it's at like 5 degrees angle attack in the file, then the way it's saved in the file, it's going to reflect that if it's toggled off. So just kind of double check whether that is turned on or off. Now that we've talked about some of the file formats, let's go ahead and open up the Clark Y data file that we downloaded just to kind of look over the format and potentially modify it if it's not in the correct format. Because this first line is the name of the airfoil, it's not going to be a plain format unless we remove this line, which we can if we wanted to. It's just nice to keep it there so that Xfoil recognizes the name. If you look at the next line for this airfoil, those are going to be the number of points that it uses on the upper surface and lower surface. Now, this is not in the correct format for Xfoil to recognize these numbers. So if we leave them in, it's going to cause problems, right? It's going to think those are our first two coordinate pairs. So we need to go ahead and remove that line as well. Now, if you look, the rest of it's going to be two columns of data. The first column is going to be the X coordinate. The X coordinate, of course, being between 0 and 1. And then the Y coordinate. If you scroll through the file, look at the coordinate points, you will notice that it starts at the leading edge with 0, 0. If you look at the Y values, they're positive. So this gives us an indication it's going over the upper surface, right? The upper surface should have more positives than negative values. The leading edge, so it goes from the leading edge, goes through positive values, and it stops at the trailing edge at 1, 0, right? So that's what it does first. It goes, starts at the leading edge, goes over the upper surface, and stops at the trailing edge. The next set of data starts at the leading edge again, but then if you look at the Y values, you'll see that they're negative. And it goes all the way to the trailing edge value. Now, as we discussed on the last slide, this is actually an incorrect format for the file. If we try to put this in, Xfoil is going to have issues, and it's not going to allow us to import the airfoil correctly. So we're going to need to modify and resave this file before we actually open up Xfoil to import it. Now that's not too difficult. You can either copy and paste each line to put them in a correct order. Another trick might be opening up the file in Excel and rearranging it in Excel using some of the sort features. That's usually pretty quick, a lot quicker than trying to manually copy and cut and paste to get the coordinate pairs in the correct order. As we discussed previously, the correct file format has the coordinate points starting at the trailing edge, going over one of the surfaces, going through the leading edge, going over the other surface, and returning to the trailing edge. So what we're going to have to do is we're going to have to rearrange these points to do the same. So the first section you see there, where it goes from the leading edge to the trailing edge with the positive Y values, we're going to have to actually kind of invert that, flip it over. So the last value becomes the first one, and the first value becomes the last value. We can go ahead and leave the second data set alone, the leading edge to the trailing edge with the negative Y values, because by flipping the top data set over, It will go from the trailing edge over the top surface through the leading edge and over the negative or lower surface and return again to the trailing edge. So that's what we're looking for. So you can just flip over the top data set and it should put the file into the correct format for Xfoil. So when you do that, go ahead and save it and make sure it's in the same directory as your xfoil.exe application. At this point, we have downloaded an Airfoil coordinate file from a database. We opened it up. We found that the format was incorrect. So we went ahead and formatted the file to make sure it's in the correct format. And we went ahead and saved it. And now the next step is just to make sure that you put it in the correct location, right? Make sure that it's in the same location as your xfoil.exe application that you used to start Xfoil. So the next step would be to start Xfoil and use the load command to load the Airfoil into Xfoil. Now the load command requires a parameter of type string. This string that it's looking for is actually the file name, including the extension of the file that you're wanting to import as an Airfoil. If you forget to put this parameter in when you use the command, it will prompt for it, as you can see right there in the first option of step four. If you leave off the file name, it'll just prompt you to enter the file name with the little S and the caret prompting you that it's looking for a string. Or you can just use the parameter when you use the load command, as you see there on the second option of step four. There's some other options. You know, at this point we might look at cleaning up the paneling of the loaded Airfoil, maybe increasing the number of panels it has, or the density of the panels. We'll look at this in a future video on how we can adjust the paneling parameters of our Airfoil. And of course, we have some save commands as well. If we modify the Airfoil, we can actually save it into these different file formats that we discussed previously. And you can see there the different commands that you would use depending on which file format you want. And of course, each of them are going to request a file name string from you. So that's it. That's how to load an Airfoil into Xfoil. We're gonna go ahead and end the video here. We have successfully downloaded an Airfoil coordinate file from a database, opened it up. We modified the format of the file to make sure it was in the correct format. Then we loaded it into Xfoil. In the next video, we're going to explore the different commands available to you to adjust the paneling parameters of the current Airfoil that you have. If you haven't already, like, comment, subscribe, and on the next slide, click that link to the next video. And remember, it's just rocket science. See you in the next video.